Well, a very happy Sunday to you. This is a very happy Sunday for me and for David, who is visiting Georgia and me. Terry and Joan Benton, who brought Georgia and me to Fort Worth, made all of our move to bring us here in 2010, have season tickets in a very fine spot. Watch for us on TV, because we might wave at you there. They have invited David and me to go with them to watch the Dallas Cowboys Steelers game. And oh man, are we excited. George and I have been there before with them, but this is the first time for David and me. And what a bonding time. I know that we are having the time of our life, and this will really add to it. This is a church day, and I hope that you've been to church or that you're going to go to church. We go to church on Saturdays at Gateway Church in South Lake, Texas, and a humongous church that has services on Saturday and Sunday all alike. But since we go on Saturday, I guess this technically makes us Seventh-day Adventists. So anyway, the book. The great book, Jonathan Kahn's book, The Harbinger, Chapter 6, The Oracle. I couldn't make any sense of what was on the seal. It was some sort of composite shape, mostly rectangular, joined together in a chaotic jumble. I decided instead to focus on the clue. On the word? She asked. Yes. Pretty vague for a clue. Yes, but it was the only other thing I had to go on. So, where do you find words? In a book? And where do you find books? In a library. So, my search took me to the library. The New York Public Library. The one with the two stone lions standing guard outside and millions of books and resource materials inside. I was there virtually every day for weeks, going on any lead I could think of, searching for anything that would match the puzzling image on the seal. And did you find something? No. But one day, I was searching through a book of symbols in the main reading room, sitting on a wooden chair against one of the library's long wooden tables by the light of a reading lamp, under a massive window and a chandelier, and I took a break to look up from the page, and, well, there he was, the prophet, sitting on the other side of the table, directly across from me, silent, just watching me. I'd been so engrossed in the book, I never saw him sit down. How long have you been here?
A few minutes.
Why didn't you say something?
I was waiting.
So this is the place of our next meeting. I wasn't sure I was on the right track.
You're not. And this is not the place of our next meeting.
If this isn't the place of our next meeting, then why are you here? And why am I here? And why are we meeting?
I would call this an intervention. I'm intervening.
You're off track and you need help. Then the word isn't in this place? It is in this place. Then how can I be off track?
It is here, but you didn't have to come here to find it. In fact, you didn't even have to leave home.
But if it's here, I don't understand how I can be off track or why you would have to come to intervene.
I came to help you find the third harbinger and to give you the key to unlock all the harbingers. I'm listening. The nine harbingers, what are they?
Signs, warnings, given to a nation in danger of judgment.
And to whom did they first appear?
To the people of ancient Israel.
And when did they first appear?
At the time of the breach, the first invasion.
So then, that's where you need to look. Nariel, in 732 BC, when the Assyrians invaded the land, that's where the word is.
What does that mean?
A word was given, a prophetic word.
The word I've been searching for?
Yes.
With that, he reached into the inner lining of his coat and pulled out an object, a roll, placed it on the table and carefully began unrolling it under the incandescent glow of the lamp. It appeared to be an ancient parchment on which were written words of an ancient-looking script.
It looks like a piece of the Dead Sea Scrolls, I said.
It was the nearest thing I could think of to describe what I was seeing.
It does. But it's not a piece of the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Nope. But close.
What is it?
He didn't answer, but passing his finger over the parchment, he began reading aloud the ancient words. Devar Shaka Adonai.
Which means what?
Devar, a word.
Shaka has been sent.
Adonai, the Lord.
A word has been sent, Lord?
A word has been sent by the Lord.
Devar Shaka Adonai, the Lord has sent a word.
Yaakov, to Jacob, and it has fallen upon Israel, and all the people will know it.
Ephraim and those who dwell in Samaria, who in pride and arrogance of heart say
what?
What I'm about to read, Noriel, is the message given to ancient Israel in the days after that first attack. In this lies the key to unlock all the harbingers.
How?
By revealing their mysteries, the key to the nation's future.
The future of ancient Israel.
And the future of America. Once again, he began passing his finger over the scroll and reciting its ancient words. This is the message. Now, listen carefully.
Lavinyam, the bricks.
Naflalu, have fallen.
Vigazit, but with hewn stone.
Nivna, we will rebuild.
Shikmim,
the sycamores.
Gudavu,
have been cut down.
The Erezim,
but with cedars.
Na'kalif,
we will plant in their place.
The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with hewn stone.
The sycamores have been cut down, but we will plant cedars in their place.
It wasn't what I expected him to say, Nariel said.
What did you expect?
Something relevant. Something of significance. What did bricks and sycamore trees have to do with America? Or anything?
And I told him. I don't understand. I don't even know what it's saying. How is it the key?
This is Israel's response to the first invasion.
the first calamity. These are the words that sum up the nation's spirit, a spirit of pride, defiance, and arrogance in the face of the calamity. And why is it significant? Because these are the words that seal the nation's course and foretell its future. I'm not seeing it. What exactly is it, Noriel, that they're really saying? In the aftermath of the invasion, they're going to rebuild. And why would that be significant? I have no idea. It's what you do when something's destroyed. You rebuild. Look deeper, Noriel. What's the larger context? A nation is turning away from God. Its hedge of protection has been removed. Why? To cause them to turn back, to wake them up, to save them from a greater judgment. And what are they doing in the light of it? What are they not doing? They're not returning to God. Exactly. Instead of listening to the alarm, instead of turning back, instead of even pausing for a moment to re-examine their ways, they boast of their resolve. It wasn't about rebuilding at all. It was about ignoring the warning and rejecting the call to return. So they missed their warning. They did more than that. They defied it. Notice the words. They weren't vowing just to rebuild what was destroyed, but to make themselves stronger than before, to become invulnerable to any attack. So what they're saying is this: we will not be humbled. We will not search our ways or consider the possibility that something could be wrong. Instead, we'll defy the calamity, we'll beat it back, we'll rebuild, we'll undo the damage as if it had never happened. Not only will we not change our course, we'll pursue it now with even more zeal. We'll come out of this calamity stronger than ever and rise to even greater heights than before. They were saying all those words in those few words. That's exactly what they were saying. That's exactly what it means. The alarm had sounded and they were vowing to silence it. And what happens, Noriel, if you silence an alarm? You keep sleeping. And if the alarm was to warn you of danger, what then? Then the danger becomes even more dangerous, because now you have nothing to warn you that is coming. Exactly. So they kept sleeping. They nullified the alarm that was meant to wake them up, to save them. And it was all there in the vow. The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with hewn stone. The sycamores have been cut down, but we will plant cedars in their place. These are the words that seal a nation's destiny. The fate of the entire nation hanging on so few words. And in the original language, even fewer, eight words. But how? Well, the vow was a sign, a manifestation of the hardening of their hearts, the rejection of God's calling, the sealing of the nation's defiance and its course, and thus the sealing of its end. So the vow itself is a sign of judgment. Question. You told me that the word I was looking for wasn't just here in the library, that I didn't have to come here to find it. How could I possibly have found that parchment without you showing it to me? Oh, it's not the parchment. It's the word. And the word is from the book of a prophet. A prophet who lived at the time of the invasion and through whom the word was given. And the prophet was Yeshayahu. I've never heard of him. You have, you just didn't really know his name. You know him as Isaiah. Isaiah. The word is from the Bible, from the book of Isaiah, the 9th chapter, Isaiah 9:10. Isaiah 9:10. So it's known. Well, not really, it's very obscure. It's a verse you could pass over easily. Even most of those who read the Bible every day would have little idea that that verse existed. So, what does all this have to do with America? The prophecy in its context concerned ancient Israel, but now, as a sign, it concerns America. How? It's the sign of a nation that once knew God, but then fell away. A sign that America is now the nation in danger of judgment, and now given warning and the call to return. So it was originally given to Israel, but now it's given as a sign to America? Yes. So if that same prophetic message, that same warning of judgment, once given in Israel's last days, should now manifest itself in America, it will be a sign that America is now the nation that once knew God but then fell away and is now in danger of judgment and now given warning and a calling to return. So if that word should be manifested in America, it becomes a harbinger of America's future. A harbinger, and more than one. The 9 harbingers. Yes, the 9 harbingers. Each one joined to the ancient prophecy, each one joined to this word, and each one carrying a revelation. If these harbingers of Israel's judgment should now reappear, along with this prophetic word, then the nation in which they reappear is in danger. And you're saying that they have reappeared. Yes. All of them. All 9. And they've all reappeared in America? Yes. And they all concern America? Yes. And Isaiah 9:10 is the key to all of them? Yes. It's the key that unlocks each of their mysteries and joins them all together. Each of the harbingers is connected. Each, when joined together with the other 8, forms a prophetic message. And each mystery is itself a puzzle piece in a still larger mystery. So 2 of the harbingers you've revealed, what are the other 7? That would be telling. It's for you to find them. And it's for you to help me. I just gave you the key. You could give me a little more to go on. He paused as if carefully pondering every word that was about to proceed out of his mouth. Then just as carefully and deliberately, he began to speak. 2 of the 9 you already know, the breach and the terrorist. These form the context. And as for the other 7, one is of stone, the other is fallen, one ascends, one is alive, the other once was alive. One speaks of what is and the other speaks of what would be. There was a long pause before I ventured a response. You know, I'm not telling you how to do your job, but that would be a lot easier if you just gave me a map and a few subway tokens. You don't need a token. You have the key.
And what do I do with it?
You use it to find the third harbinger.
And that's it.
Tomorrow it starts to deepen. We have still been doing kind of it builds, and you'll see that all through the book, and it gets better and deeper and more wonderful, and you're learning more about your God and my God. Oh, this God rocks. And what a mathematician. You wait till you see. And I'll be back with you for the next chapter, chapter 7 tomorrow. It's called The Third Harbinger, The Fallen Bricks. Meanwhile, go Cowboys!